So, what I'm trying to do is to create lecture notes that are complementary, as I mentioned, with respect to other material that you have, books, scripts, and so on. Okay? So they are going to be with very little writings, but with kind of slogan-like text, such that you see what is really important, that you really need to stick it in your brain. Okay? And then I'm going to basically try to reproduce what I'm doing at the blackboard. It's going to be very similar or identical to what you find in the lecture notes. Okay, so if you have problems in reading the board, when you look at the videos, you have the notes, you can see what I'm doing. Okay, so it's going to be, you have all the assistance that you can possibly have. Okay, one thing, another disclaimer. In the process, it's likely that I'm going to make mistakes at the board. You know, maybe I mistook a two, or I don't know, an index that doesn't have a pedix, and it's missing, or something like that. That's because I'm trying to speak a lot. Okay, so during the lecture, I'm trying to integrate what I didn't write here by speaking a lot, and this kind of is a distraction for me. Okay, from the equations. So if you notice it, just let me know, but be patient on that. Okay, tolerate that, please. Do not tolerate if there are mistakes in the scripts. Okay? So in the lecture note there are mistakes, I mean shout loud. Okay? And be angry at me. Okay, good. So let's now continue what we did last time. So we basically went through the motivation for this lecture. So you have seen how many aspects Newtonian gravity is failing due to observations, and how we can kind of try to change our way of thinking of gravity, not by thinking in terms of a force, but by the fact that we might be dealing with a non-inertial frame, which is coming from the intrinsic property of the space-time, as we are going to see. Okay? And it is was the link that I did through the equivalence principle, in which we also made our experiment with the bottle outside in the garden, in which I was drilling a hole at the bottom of the container. When I was holding the bottle, the own pressure of the water plus the atmospheric one, which was equiparted by the internal one from the external one, you remember that I had to open the top of the bottle such to allow the flow to come out. Anyway, the gravity of the water was kind of pushing on itself, and there was an outward flow, like a little fountain. As soon as I dropped the bottle, in the very instant in which I left the bottle, the flow stopped. Why? Because the bottle was in free, and the water were free-falling, and they don't experience any more gravity. There was a G acceleration downward from our planet. They were accelerating in the same way, and they were in free fall. They don't feel gravity. So you see that according to the rest frame, the frame of reference, in this case accelerated frames, we can kind of remove locally gravity, or if we are in, let's say, in presence of no gravitational source, such as a matter source or something like that, then we can kind of mimic gravity by accelerating our container. Okay, we have seen the various elevator experiments that I've drawn at the board. Okay, so there is this equivalence between gravity and non-inertial frames. Before going into that, I would like to dig in a little bit more into something that is linked to Newtonian gravity, and use still a non-relativistic approach. Of course, classical, so non-quantistic, and try to exploit as much information as possible and see which kind of phenomena can even be replicated with this sort of approach. Okay? So what we are going to do is to use the least action principle. You know that it's going to give us the Euler-Lagrange equation. Out of which we can get the equation of motion of particles, if for the Lagrangian that we are going to use in defining our action, we are going to incorporate the action of a particle, or is going to be the equation of motion of the field. And in this case, we speak about field equations, in which we see the behavior and the properties of the field given an initial Lagrangian. So now we want to construct the theory, and so we need first to decide which kind of theory we want to arrive at which end. So the first thing we want to do is to have a linear theory. In such a way that we can respect the superposition principle that we know holding in Newtonian gravity. What's the superposition principle? Well, you know that if you have a massive object, it's going to create a gravitational field. You know that if you have a second massive object, it's going to create another gravitational field, which might differ because perhaps it's more massive than the previous one. Plus, if you have another one, and so on and so forth, you know that the potential, that you know that the total potential that you have is going to be the sum of the potentials of the individual sources. Yes? Because now, for the moment, I'm sticking to, so I'm going in steps. So at the moment, I'm kind of, I showed you Newtonian gravity, now I'm doing a little bit more. Yeah. Okay? And I still stick to the linear theory because it's simple, that it's also easier to do it at the blackboard, and I can have an analytical clean solution at the end. Okay. So we have our superposition principle, and for our Lagrangian, actually, we are dealing with a Lagrangian density. So if you make the integral of this Lagrangian with respect to volume, you have the Lagrangian. What we care about is what's happening locally in a certain region of space. Can only be depending on the potential value. And two derivative, which index I used, E. And two derivatives of the potential. Okay? Now, just a little bit of notation. With this dE, I mean dxE, and it can be written in several ways. Well, let's use Sophie. You see, you can write the same thing in several ways. I guess you are aware with that through electrodynamics lectures. So you see that the derivative with respect to xE, so x component of the potential can be simplified with delta E phi or phi comma E. Okay? This is a scalar. Phi is a scalar. And we are talking about the equation of motion of a field, so the field's equation. It's not that the field is going, you know, from here to there. What we are tracking is the potential in a certain position, and we're going to see how it's evolving as a function of time, if we make it evolve as a function of time, or if we let it evolve as a function of time, or what is the difference between phi in this position and this position. It's not that you have to imagine like the particle which is moving somewhere, but it's the property of the potential changing in a certain location, okay? Or the property of the potential in a certain location. And similarly, it's the same of the particle, because you have the picture of the particle moving around, but actually is a particle, and what is changing is its own property, and the only property that we can let to a particle which is neutral is the position. So x is the property of the particle, phi is the property of the potential. So that's how you should think at the equation of motions of the field, or if you wish, at the at the equation of motion of the field. Then what we want to have an isotropic field, resulting field, in case we have, for example, a spherical symmetric distribution of matter. 3. Then what we want to respect isotropy, which means that our potential needs to contain a term which is an Abla squared of the potential. That in this notation, I can as well write the E of phi, where I introduced here the Einstein notation, in which if you have whatever thing you have, now I can write X, can be an operator, can be anything. If you see two repeated indices up and down, you know that you need to read it as something like that. Okay, that's the summary over the index that is repeated. This is a dummy index. Dummy because it's inside a summatory, and therefore at the end when you play the summatory, this is just some real number with no indices. Okay, that's why it's called dummy index. Why is that? Because when we apply the least action principle, you see there is kind of derivatives are involved in the process, and this Nabla square, the square is kind of coming down, so to say, and this gives us something which is linear. Okay? Plus, this operator can be easily written into spherical coordinates. Okay? Which is good for isotropy, that's the game we are playing. Good. Now we go for the equation of motions. And yes?
In quantum field theory, we learned that the Hopfer index is not only implying the Einstein estimation, but also the multiplication with the metric. So this is already intuitive.
So we're talking about Newtonian mechanics.
No
problem. That's good that you pointed out. So we're talking about Newtonian mechanics. Therefore, when I'm talking about the indices here, it's a non-relativistic theory. Therefore, we're not dealing with the space-time as we're going to do in very short time. But the indices are 1, 2, 3. There is not in the dependency the time as well, the time itself. Good, so let's go for the equation of motion. So we have the Euler Lagrange equation in which we are plugging in our Lagrangian. The variable is the potential, and then we have the derivatives of the potential that must be derived with two degrees. The E and then the L over the phi comma E equal to zero. Good, that's the framework, that's what we want to do. Now we just need to define the Lagrangian and what we're going to do is to find the most general Lagrangian you can possibly use. Okay? Such that it respects all what we said there. So these two points, isotropy for a spherical symmetric source and a linear theory. So, yes? No, here I'm just using annotation. So this is just annotation, just to briefly summarize summaries with something that is not, I don't need to carry a summary around. But the meaning is clear, okay? Then with respect to covariant, contravariant, one forms, and so on, we are going to have quite a deal of that in the next lectures. Okay, let's go for the Lagrangian, which is going to define our system, in this case the field. So we have phi comma E. And this is equal to one kinetic term, which contains a square, de phi, which represents the self-interaction of the field. Okay, that's kind of the field that interacts with itself. Plus, we have some constants that are used to set the units in such that we can reproduce the Newton's law, so these are just constants, times the source of the field and the potential that plays the interaction between the matter, in this case rho, which is matter density, and the potential itself. Plus, we are allowed to have a linear term into the potential that in the least action principle is going to give us a constant term. And then we are allowed as well to have something that is of second order with respect to phi. Again, we have a constant, so that this is a square. And the factor of 2 is just placed for convenience. And alpha is just a constant that is going to quantify something that we need to understand from the equation what's its meaning. Okay? So that's our Lagrangian. So we have the self-interaction, interaction matter potential, and then two terms that we can have. Maybe we don't need them, because then we try our theory against nature, and then we can set lambda and alpha equal to 0, or g equal to 0. At the moment, we don't know. Okay? Good. So let's do that. So our Euler Lagrange equation, so I need to take first the derivative with respect to the potential of this term. So we have the Lagrangian with respect to the phi. So you see I am finding these two terms, 1 and 2. And we have, this is derivative, this is phi comma dot, that there's no playing there. Ah, we have it here, we have it there, and we have it there. So that's equal to 4 pi g rho, this goes on. Then we have plus lambda plus 2, that cancel with this 2, that's why I placed it, alpha square, same. Then we go for the other term, which is the derivative with respect to the derivative of the potential. And we have the L over the phi comma E, and there is no phi comma E, there is no phi comma E, so we can completely forget about them. The only term that we have is this one. Since we have this product, there is a 2 coming down that cancel with that one, and we get the E. See. It's better because I put the index down, so it's better to have this one. And so it should be this one because this is down. Okay. Good. Now that we have that, we can plug our two terms in our Euler Lagrange equation. And what we then get is 4 pi g rho plus lambda plus alpha square c minus the other guy, minus delta E. C. And of course, this has to be equal to 0. Now, what I will try to do is to kind of find something that looks like our beloved old Poisson equation. And I just put all groups with our gradient. So you see, these are the E. If we take all the three components, this is equivalent to that. Okay. And we have our nabla squared minus alpha squared multiplied by phi, so I'm just grouping these two terms together. And this is going to be equal to 4 pi g rho, and then we have our lambda, plus lambda. And for making my life simpler, I can call this nabla squared this sort of delta. Okay? Minus, yes.
From the order.
Ah, you're right. Because this is just the derivative with respect to E, and then there is this delta E in addition. And therefore, here we have, where is it? Here. The E. Okay, because here I just play the derivative of the Lagrangian, but then on top of that we have this one. Okay, that give us this Nabla squared. So you see that it kind of look like a Poisson's equation, but it's richer. There are other terms on top of it. And we should try to understand what is their meaning. That's what we want to understand, the meaning of these equations. And what you see in a non-classical approach, non-relativistic approach, actually gravity has three constants, not one. That's already kind of surprising. You see, it's already richer in itself because somebody might, I mean, I want to do that because one can think, you can get the acceleration of the universe through the cosmological constant only through general relativity. It's not true. Okay? Already with this approach, you have it. Anyway, let's see now what G is. I guess that you already know, but let's do it explicitly. And to do it, for convenience, we set the other constants, lambda and alpha equal to zero, such that we have Nabla phi is equal to 4 pi g rho, which is our standard Poisson equation.
How can we with this say that there has to be a g and there has to be a lambda? Because like, it seems to me as if I could, for example, also split g into two different parts and say there's g1 and g2. Because isn't that essentially what we did with lambda? Because it, like, couldn't one just apply a constant which includes g and lambda?
Yeah, but you see the difference that here there is the source which might have a special dependency, for instance, you know, whereas this is just a scalar number and it's fixed, so that's why they are split apart. Okay, so you see that we set the other equations, so the other terms lambda and alpha equal to zero, get our beloved Poisson equation, the standard one. Which is what Newton did, basically. I mean, he didn't have the Euler-Lagrange equation or this fancy mathematics at ends, but he said, well, that's enough. This is going to give us, in the end, an attractive force. So let's see. So what we said. We said spherical symmetric symmetry. Therefore, we can use, for convenience, instead of using Nabla squared, instead of using this operator, we can express it in terms, not in Cartesian coordinates, as we did here, but into polar coordinates. And so our Nabla turns into a 1 over R square. Then we have d over the R square of the phi over the R. Okay? So this is this first term here in polar coordinates. Polar coordinates, which is equal to the stuff that is there and that we are not touching. Okay, now we go to solve this simple equation, so we just need to integrate it twice. We can bring the R2 on the other side, and then we integrate with respect to the R, so that we have R squared, the phi over the R, equal to 4 pi g rho r to the power 3 over 3 plus an integration constant. We still have a derivative here, so let's get rid of these two. This becomes a 1, and then we have a r to the power 2 on this side. Let's integrate it again, such that we get phi. In the end, our potential phi is going to be 4 pi g rho. One. R to the power of 2, 3, and 2, I put it here, plus A, and you see I'm integrating R to the minus 2, that gives us a R plus the integration constant. Now, what are these two constants? We need to set border conditions, and we want that the potential to go to zero if R is going to infinite. So far away from our source, basically we cannot feel anymore the source and the potential should go to zero. You say this is a constant, therefore this must be zero, otherwise it would not go to zero because it would stay different than zero. This is even growing with radius, therefore also A must be equal to zero. And we have 4 pi 3 g rho r to the power of 2 over 2. Now, what do we have here? We have 4 pi 3 rho r to the power of 2. We can make it r to the power of 3 and then divide by r. Such that we have what? We have a density times a volume. 4 pi over 3, r to the power of 3, is the volume of a sphere. Okay, so if we integrate over a volume, you see, this is the matter up to R. Okay? Where R is the radius of our sphere. Therefore, I can, let me do it here. Therefore, what we have in the end is mg over R. Where the one, where the r to the minus one dependency is popping up. Standard Newtonian gravity, and this is going to give us an attractive force. Okay? If we set even rho equal to zero, we play exactly the very same trick, but instead of having all of that, we have equal to zero. Let me do it here, then I will clean up the board. Therefore, we are going to have again our term here. So we have our 1 over r squared. Then we have d over dr of r squared of d phi over the r equal to zero. You see, I'm setting rho equal to zero, yes?
Why is an integration of one a little bit confused?
Yeah, because this is already integrated, because this is the density time. I mean, this is rho, which we are assuming constant, for instance. We are not getting a rho dependency. This is already the volume of a sphere. So that's rho times the volume of a sphere. Thanks. Good. We play the same trick. So we have r to the power of 2, which is larger or equal than 0. So we can just drop it, because we have an equal on the other side. We have our integral, r squared d phi over the r equal to an integration constant. This gives us r to the minus 2 if I bring it on the other side. And now I can integrate once more, and I get our phi, which is again directly proportional to r to the minus 1. Therefore, also when there is no matter, so outside our field, outside our source of matter, we have a gravitational potential, which still goes with r to the minus 1. Yes? Wait, where are you? Here?
Here, yeah.
Because you start, so you start with that, and you make the integral, and you get the A, and then you get the R on the other side. R to the minus 2 has a power. I integrate once. Yes, you're right. Wait, what have I done? There's it. So, R2 goes here. We integrate R squared the phi over the R, 4 pi g rho R3 over 3 plus A. Yes. That's it. Then we integrate and we have the R. Yes. Probably later when I was speaking, I just copied again the R2 on the others. Okay, good. Okay. And this is kind of all normal. That's something that we already know. Good. Now we continue and we study the other terms, the other two constants that are a little bit funnier. And we go for lambda. So we set g equal to 0 and alpha equal to 0. If we now get our initial equation, that is the enriched Poisson equation, we set these two terms equal to 0, what we get is the phi equal to lambda. OK? So we do the same, very same business. We use polar coordinates, all of that. So we have our own power of 2 d over dr. Then we have r squared d phi over dr equal to lambda. And we perform again our usual integral. Yes? Yes, we set rho to 0, we have our nabla square, we make our integrals of the left-hand side. On the other side, we just have an integration constant that pops up. So let's keep one integral, so r squared, then we have d phi over dr equals to the integration constant. That's the first one. Then we go for the second integration, so we have r to the power of 2. That goes here. So that's r to the minus 2, OK? Then we make the integral again. We have phi a, which is equal to a, r to the minus 1. R two plus 1, two plus, okay, wait. And then plus 1, plus the integration constant. Yes, plus B. And same condition, b equal to 0 at infinite, and that's what we have. OK? Good. What are we left here?
So I don't repeat the exercise here. You understand what's the story. So we just perform our integral. And in the end, we get a potential, which is phi, equal to lambda over 6 to the power of 2. OK? So if I still messed it up, forget about it. Now I don't have the time to go through it and fix my own brain. OK? But that's the story. It's clean what is happening, right? In this case, we have that. And if we look at the acceleration, which is the phi over the r, which is the interesting part, which is going to tell you what is the dependency of the potential, you know that the phi over the r is equal to minus the acceleration. Guys, sorry. No, I understand that. I understand that there is a mistake, but frankly, I don't care. Okay. So I'd like to show you here the physics. Then you get the notes and you look and you fix it. Okay. Okay. Are you fine with that? Otherwise, we are there because now I have the pressure of time and I need to get it done. I'm not even really thinking at the equation. So I'm just trying to explain you what's going on here. Okay, so you know that this is the acceleration, and this tells you that the acceleration given that is equal lambda r over 3. The acceleration that is inserted onto a massive particle goes with the power of r. It means that it grows as we go away. Okay, completely different behavior from what we had before. This is equivalent to the cosmological constant. Lambda gives the cosmological constant in this non-relativistic approach. Now let's go for alpha. Alpha equal to what? Again, we set g equal to 0 and lambda equal to 0. And in this case, we have nabla alpha square, our nabla square alpha square phi equal to 0. You see that this guy doesn't care if there is a rho or not. We perform our integral, same story. And we end with phi. So in this case, we have a second order linear differential equation that we need to solve. And what we end up is with r to the minus 1. So that's exactly what we have with standard Newtonian gravity. So it's going to give us exactly this Newtonian gravity. But since we are dealing here with a second order differential equation, we are getting an exponential of minus alpha r. Alpha is responsible for shielding. Like when you have a plasma in electrodynamics where the local charge is shielded by the surrounding charge. Here we have something which physically is very different. But the effect is the same. So we have this alpha constant that plays the role of a shielding. You see, there is like a r to the minus 1 decay of our potential getting lower and lower. And at a certain point, boom, we have an exponential cutoff. OK? So it's kind of the effect of gravity are acting on a shorter range. Can we, with this theory, that's great, because we managed to reproduce a behavior that was not foreseen by Newton, namely the possibility that shielding exists. Maybe it doesn't, and we need to set it equal to 0. Currently, we need to set it equal to 0 because observations say so. But we have the freedom to include it. But we have lambda, which is needed because our universe shows an acceleration on extremely large scales. Okay, so you see, we can reproduce that. But we cannot reproduce a lot of other issues. Such, for example, we cannot fix the perihelion shift of Mercury or of other bodies that are feeling a relatively strong gravitational field. We cannot deal properly with gravitational lensing. We don't have retardation, and we don't have all of that. Okay, so you see that there are still a lot of limitations. But it's good, it's funny to see how many how rich physics we can reproduce in this moment. Now, it's funny, and I'd like to also stick a moment to the r to the minus 1 factor that we have in in the Newtonian gravity potential. And what is the link to geometry? To the geometry of the space-time. And to look at this link between geometry and the space and the space-time and the fact that we have a minus one as an exponent there, we're going to use the Gauss theorem. That allow us to link integrals over volume with respect to integrals over surfaces areas. So let's see. As we said, we have the acceleration that is related to that. We are dealing with a conservative force. We can express a potential with respect to a force. Then we have our nabla square equal, I just write it explicitly, so our nabla square, which is equal to minus the gradient of g. So I just, you see, this is a g is already a gradient of phi, therefore I can just write it in this way. The minus is there, is equal to 4 pi g rho. Right? This is the standard Poisson equation in which I'm setting alpha and lambda equal to 0. Now we try to exploit Gauss theorem that allows to link volumes to densities, and therefore, you know, volumes and density are referring to geometry, to properties of the geometry of space. And we integrate over volume the phi, which is equal to what? We can plug our expression here that we have from up there and relate it to the acceleration. Therefore, this is the integral, still over the volume, of the gradient of g in the x cube. And now we can use, you see, we have a gradient, the integral of a gradient in a volume. Now we can use Gauss theorem and link it to an integral over the surface defining the volume, in which the gradient disappears, and with respect to an area. Then similarly, I can work with the equation there and link, since we are making an integral of nabla square over phi, I have an integral over rho, I can relate it to the total mass, to the total matter associated to the source of the potential. Therefore, we have the very same thing. That's equal to 4 pi g, and then we have the integral with respect to the volume of rho in the x cube over the very same volume. And this is equal to 4 pi g, and then that's the mass up to the volume. And if we assume that all matter is contained within our radius r, then this is a constant, because I'm increasing the volume, but this is all matter that I have, and it's not going to grow anymore. Sorry?
So, divergence of G.
Yes.
So it's dot product. So not gradient.
Yeah, it's that you have the scalar product there. Yes, because G is an acceleration, it's a vector. Nabla is a vector, and that's a scalar product again in 3D with 1, 2, 3 indices. Same here, we have a scalar product, where usually, when you have an area like this, also the area is a vector, okay? That's because you can get the D area is usually defined with a vector, because the area, the surface can point, you know, in different directions. Therefore, the area is a vector, which length, I mean, the magnitude, the absolute value of the vector tells you how large is the area. And the direction of the vector tells you what is the orientation of the area. And why is this relevant here? Because we have G, which is a vector pointing somewhere, and then we have an area, and the meaning of this term here is that this dG, sorry, this G is actually the flux through an area of dG. So mathematically, you can read G as a flux across the area. Okay? But then what does it mean? It means that if we are taking, for example, our volume, the V, so the, which is the surface enclosing the volume, and we take a sphere, 4 pi r square. Okay? But when this is true? When the geometry is Euclidean. If we are taking a non-Euclidean space, then this is not the case anymore. So you see that this r to the power of minus 1 of our potential is strictly related to the geometry of space-time. And if we are not in a Euclidean space-time, then we expect the potential to behave in a different way. Okay? Yes?
Sorry, what is the root of the loop? I just can't read the word. What is the loop?
Sorry, what? Euclidean space. This one? Flux. Anyway, this was a bug. Across area. Welcome. Okay, good. Good, so now we can have a break. We can resume. I would say in 5 minutes at 10 past 15, so that I can check the video also and see that everything is working well.